I'd like to welcome you all to tonight's OFFER educational meeting. My name is Peggy Rosati-Allen, and I am an OFFER volunteer. And my special connection to tonight's topic is that I'm the parent of three children, one of whom is a daughter who is now 18 and has been sick with chronic fatigue syndrome since the age of 12, and she is in our audience tonight. I am very grateful and thankful to our six panelists who are here with us tonight, and want to start by acknowledging and again thanking them for dedicating the time, and I know the energy that it takes for you to be with us here tonight. We appreciate it very much. Misperceptions about chronic fatigue syndrome and fibromyalgia as being all in your head, limited resources, and lack of education among healthcare providers have not only been barriers to effective diagnosis and treatment of these illnesses, but have also created a social context of illness with chronic fatigue syndrome and fibromyalgia that adds significant burden to coping for affected individuals and their families. Although more adults than children and adolescents become ill with chronic fatigue syndrome and fibromyalgia, the impact of these illnesses on young lives during times of critical personal, social, and academic development cannot be underestimated. Our panelists tonight range in age from 17 to 24. All have chronic fatigue syndrome, and some both chronic fatigue syndrome and fibromyalgia. Length of time with illness ranges from less than 1 year to over 10 years. They are here to share their stories to increase awareness of the effects of chronic fatigue syndrome and fibromyalgia in young people, to share insight and wisdom for coping, and to lend support to others in the audience and in our community who may be dealing with similar challenges. So with that, let's meet our panelists.
Anyway. I'm Kyle Reinhardt, and I'm 17, and I was diagnosed when I was 16. And I'm currently still in school. I only have two classes a day in high school, but so kind of part-time, I guess, and not really able to work or anything. But
My name is Erin Jackson. I'm 22 years old, and I have chronic fatigue and fibromyalgia. I was diagnosed when I was around 13 or 14, but I've had pretty severe symptoms since I was 10. I'm currently going to BYU part-time this semester. I have been able to go almost full-time one semester, so I'm pretty proud of that, actually. And I'm studying to be a video editor. And I haven't been able to work yet. I was able to graduate high school. I went to that part-time. And yeah, that's pretty much me.
My name is Jessica Turner, and I'm 24. I have chronic fatigue, which is gradually turning into fibromyalgia also. And I was 20 when I was diagnosed, but I've had it since I was 16. And currently I am a stay-at-home mom. And I graduated from high school barely, and went to the Salt Lake Community College, which is on hold.
Yeah. My name is Amy Inchef. I'm 20 years old. I have chronic fatigue syndrome and fibromyalgia. I was diagnosed when I was 14 years old. I'm currently a student, barely full time. I'm taking 12 credits, just the minimum for my insurance, and. I am able to work once a week, so gas money, pretty much it.
My name is Jenny Morgan, and I am 21 years old. I was diagnosed when I was 17, and I luckily am able to work now. I have a couple jobs, but I haven't been able to return to school since I was diagnosed. I was able to graduate from high school, but haven't had any college yet.
Hi, I'm Peggy Wallace. I'm 18. I was just diagnosed this fall. I have fibromyalgia and CFS, and the doctors think I also have POTS. I'm homeschooled. My mom does some of the work, but mostly it's a computer program. I'm in 12th grade and hoping to graduate this spring, and I'm not able to work.
All right. How do you describe your illness to peers who may ask about it, Kyle?
A lot of people I found know, like, about mono, and you know, they know a lot of people that have had it, and sometimes I'll just say that it's like having mono, but maybe double, or there's a lot more symptoms, and you know, I don't need to describe them to them, like, everything that happens, but they know how hard it is to function like that, I guess, so.
And then Kyle, second part of this, let's go ahead and address that now. Is there a typical reaction you get from peers when you explain?
People are usually sympathetic, but then they still don't really fully understand. Like, I'll tell someone and they'll still want to go play basketball or something. And I have to, you know, explain to them some of the limitations. But everyone's usually sympathetic, though.
Yeah. How do you explain those limitations?
Like, how so? What do you mean?
Like, when they say, let's go play basketball, is there a typical response that you've learned that works well?
I tell them that if I go do that, I'll be in bed for, you know, a long time. No, I might not even be able to really be that much of an asset if we were out doing that.
Yeah, it's sort of have similar reactions to as Kyle, and I usually explain with mono as well, or the flu, or I describe the symptoms as best that I can, because I think a lot of people are really interested if they aren't familiar with the illness. If they are, I usually get, oh, my aunt has that, or my grandma has that, and maybe you should talk to them. And, you know, it's definitely something that most people haven't associated with anyone my age. Especially since, you know, when I was like 11, it was just something that it was almost impossible to describe to my peers then. But people are really understanding, I think. They try to be, at least. Explaining limitations is more difficult, I found, because, you know, I think some people tend to be personally offended if you turn down an activity, if they don't, because it's difficult for them to completely understand that some days I'll feel well enough to do something and then someday I won't be. So that's probably the biggest obstacle in that, I found.
My favorite one is when people say, oh yeah, I had that once. But usually it just depends on their interest level. Some people really like to go deep into what it is and how it works and why, how you got it. And some people, they just want the superficial one sentence answer. And so I just give them an answer based on how much interest they show. And I've also tried to think of a few analogies that try kind of help them understand. I'll compare myself to a rechargeable battery that is defaulting, and so you charge it up and it'll work for a little while and then all of a sudden just drops off and stops working. And I've also thought of one, it's kind of like driving a manual car on the freeway in second or third gear, where you're just running so much energy but you're not getting anywhere. And so those are a couple things I like to try.
I really like those. And for the most part, when I kind of describe what it is, I usually go with the mono thing. Just mono, but on steroids, so it lasts a really, really long time. In a lot of cases, that usually gets most of my friends to understand what's going on. I've had real mixed reactions. Some people are offended. They think that I'm just trying to come up with an excuse to not hang out with them or get out of, you know, after a certain amount of times, they get a point where they just stop asking because I keep turning them down and they don't quite get it, that's a recurring thing. In those cases, I usually try to take them aside and really, really go deep into what exactly it is and try to explain a little bit more, try to get their interest into it. And just, you know, I hate having to kind of separate myself from friends, but I've had to do that in the past with some people who just didn't get it and found that it was actually a real emotional drain that made me a lot worse with dealing with them. So I really liked your analogies. I'm happy to use those, so, but I think it'll be good.
When people ask me what chronic fatigue and fibromyalgia is, I say a few things. So first of all, I say, how much time do you have? And another thing I say to them is that it's a lot more complex than its name. People think, oh, it's just, you're just tired. And I think that we're going to cover that later. But another thing that I say that I heard at a chronic fatigue conference a couple of years ago was that there's a monster lurking around the corner, and he just zaps all the energy out of you, and you're completely drained. So I try to tell them that and try to explain to them some of the symptoms I deal with. I've also used the mono and just kind of tried to help them understand that it's a little more advanced than mono, but it's similar. And those are usually the things that I use to describe what I have.
Okay, well, I haven't had very long at this since I was only diagnosed this fall, but usually I'll go with the mono thing, which someone suggested to me, or just kind of try to describe how I'll feel after I do something without be out of commission for a while. Most of my friends are very supportive. I don't have very many, but since I homeschooled, most of my socializing and friends are at my church. So they've been with me through the 7 years it took to get diagnosed, and they know me really well. So they're really, accepting of my answers, so I haven't really had to deal with anybody going, what's that?
In what ways, if any, do you think your illness with chronic fatigue syndrome, or CFS and fibromyalgia, has affected or shaped your personal identity?
Well, like I said, I do homeschool, so most of my time is spent in my house, and it's really hard for me to get out and around. I love to shop, but I can't do that much anymore. So I have to stay at home more, which makes me want to be around my family more, or other people, friends, that kind of thing. And I don't like to be left alone as much. I tend to do things indoors more than outdoors. With my fibromyalgia, my pain gets really bad if I get out into cold weather or something like that. So I really don't like to go outside as much unless I'm actually going on a trip or something like that.
I definitely have to make some changes since I've been diagnosed, and a lot of them have been in my personality. And I think one thing is that chronic fatigue and fibromyalgia demand a lot of patience. And I'd like to say that I've improved. I know I still have a lot of work to do in that aspect, but I'd like to think that I'm a little more patient. And another thing is it's really changed my priorities in life, because when I'm really sick and really low on energy, I can only do a few things. So I had to really look at, what is important in my life and what can I make the energy for and the time for, because I just can't do everything. So it's really helped me to understand how to better prioritize what's important to me.
I found a very similar thing. I'm much better at prioritizing. Before I got sick, I was the ultimate overachiever and had my hand in a little bit of everything and, really excelled in school. And when I got sick and I couldn't do that anymore, it was difficult to figure out exactly who I was and what to do with myself, because I'd always associated who I was with what my achievements were. And so it took some time, but I found that, I really figured out who I am with just my personality and just who I am and not what I can do or what limitations I have. I've found that I am a lot more patient. I find that I'm actually a lot more attentive to other people now.
because I'm less busy, so I can really take the time to love on other people and ensure they love back. So it's a good symbiotic relationship there. But as far as interests go, I found that really hasn't changed that much. I've always really liked outdoorsy things, and I still do them just in, you know, small amounts. And I love rock climbing. I don't get to do very much of it, but I definitely do lots of research and reading and, you know, lots of imagination, so that's good.
I thought I'd answer this one from the bigger perspective of my, I've had it for 8 years now, and I've noticed that looking back, I've kind of gone to extremes where I would try, I call it healthy Jessica and chronic fatigue Jessica, and they were two different people in my mind. And there were times when I'd go to the extreme of pushing myself so hard to be healthy Jessica that it would just really aggravate the crash cycle, and it just would get really demoralizing. And then I would say, okay, fine, I give it up at all. I'll give up everything. And I'll go to the other extreme where I'll give up healthy Jessica and give in to chronic fatigue Jessica. And that was extremely depressing also. So the challenge is to find a balance. And I agree with the other comments that I'd like to think that it's teaching me patience, and depending on what day it is, whether what answer what I'll give you, but yeah, it's about trying to realize that you can still be healthy Jessica without, while dealing with chronic fatigue.
Yeah, it's really similar thing with me. It's still shaping my identity. But every day it's like, oh, I haven't had that symptom in a while. That I've got to change some stuff now. But yeah, it's a constant. That's one of the frustrating things. There's just a constant flux of things for me. I mean, everything evolves, and with my symptoms evolving, I need to evolve along with them, and I resist the evolution, and there's a struggle with that. But before I was sick, I was like, what others have said, I was just so performance-based. I played sports, I acted, I was a Girl Scout, I went hiking a lot, and so it was just, I don't know, I associated my identity so much with those things that it was a struggle for many years to figure out, you know, what do I even want to be now? I mean, what else is there out there? And I really feel like, though, it's really deepened my character, and I feel like I have explored so many things in my life that I probably wouldn't have even given the time of day if I were completely healthy. And I feel that that's really strengthened my life, and where I am going now is the path I would never have gone down.
Well, I used to play football, and I still do that, so I really had to change, you know, all my interests revolve around that. You know, I'd go weightlifting and go exercise like that, but I really, you know, I can't do that anymore, so I had to find other things that I'm interested in. I enjoy writing and reading and stuff, and I'm in bed, I like to watch TV, and I try to see kind of the best shows to watch on TV, and it's kind of become a hobby. And I'd like to think I'm a more rounded person now, I guess. I've embraced the other side of my character, I guess.
Yeah. All right. Think about one person in your personal life, whether it be a family member or a friend, who has been especially helpful to you as you've adjusted to life with chronic fatigue syndrome and fibromyalgia. What kinds of things did this person do or say that was especially helpful to you?
Well, obviously my mom is here. She was really a great help. She, you know, helped me seek out the best medical help, dealt with the school and stuff. Also, just like, you know, one of my friends, he understands, like, that I can't always, be operating 100%. Sometimes he'll just come over and just watch TV, you know, if I don't need to make it. Have an exhausting day. Hopefully we'll still have fun. And you know, it's been very interesting at that too. That's really good.
Well, my mom is a huge support, and we really have become like best friends now throughout the process. But what I'd like to focus on is one of my friends who wasn't even really that close of a friend toward the beginning of middle school, but she was probably the only friend from that time that I'm still friends with her. It's been over probably about 8 years, and we're still very close friends. And one of the things is she just really accepted me for who I was, whoever I was that day. As I said, you know, I've just, you know, gone through so many changes, and some days I'll feel like doing some things and some days I won't. And I think it's really important to seek out those kinds of people who are just really accepting and loving, and to not have to deal with explaining things over and over again. She's just really, the preferred people who are really strong individuals themselves, I think, is important, because a lot of friends, especially in high school, are really, they're kind of needy, and they need you to call them every night. And if you don't call them every night, then they hate you, or you're mad at me, and you have to go through all of that. And so it's good to meet those kind of people. You know, maybe see them every now and then, but kind of keep at a distance, I found.
I agree with everyone. I think our mothers are our number one, and mine was, and still is. But I wanted to talk about my best friend, who later became my husband. He's sitting over here. And the thing that is especially helpful to me is he just lets me be what I am at the time. Like Aaron was saying, he lets me be down when I'm down and up when I'm up, and he doesn't push his own agenda on me. Like, we have to be here and here, and I gotta do this. It's actually the other way around. I'm the one saying, we gotta do this and this and this. And he'll say, it's okay, we don't have to do that today. And really, it's especially helpful to just receive validation and just say, it's okay, I know you're not feeling well. I know that we're not going to go to this event or that, not because you're a lazy person or you're irresponsible, because you really don't feel well. And that sometimes that's all you need. And usually, when I get the validation, then I'll say, okay, I'm well, I can go now. And you can pick yourself up and get going again.
Definitely my mom was a really big help. Especially just through the logistical side of everything, like helping you deal with the school and teachers and that side of things. But really focus on my dad was especially helpful to me. With just kind of being there, he really never said or did anything that was all that spectacular, but he just made sure that everything was always at my pace and my speed without me having to request it. And he was really, really good at just taking cues from just the way I was reacting to things, the way I was walking or talking or not paying attention or anything like that. He was able to really adapt to any situation to really help me. And in a lot of those cases, he was able to kind of take questions and answer where I would leave off, or I would, you know, go on a bunny trail that was completely beside the point. You're able to, you know, easily steer me back without making me too embarrassed or anything like that. So.
I'm going to try to use both hands. for sure, the person that sticks out in my mind is my mom, and I'm not just saying this because she's here to hear it, but the one thing that has made the most difference for me that she has done is just to listen and to trust, because there have been like so many people and so many instances where people just don't get it, they don't believe you, they're like, oh, it's in your head, like, what are you talking about, you know? And my mom has always just trusted me when I say, you know, this is what's going on, this is what I'm feeling. She's like, okay, what do we need to do about it? And in fact, I called her the other day to vent, because there was somebody that I work with kind of, and she was kind of in disbelief over what I have and what things are going on in my body. So I just called my mom and vented to her, and I just said, it's so frustrating when people don't understand, and she just always listens and trusts me when I tell her that I'm not feeling good.
I'm a born-again Christian, and God has been with me every step of the way. He's supported me when I needed it. He's carried me when I need it. I don't know if any of you have read Footprints poem, but He carries you when you can't carry yourself anymore. In the Bible, it says He's closer than a brother to us. So, you know, He's with me every moment of every day, giving me His strength. And as far as doing things, I have an entire lifetime of examples of things He's done for me. He saved me. He's given me a wonderful family. He's led me to doctors that, for the most part, have not questioned my symptoms. And He's finally led me to the answer of what's going on. 7 years is a hard time to go through without any diagnosis. The other person is my mom. She's been with me all the way through it. The first time I was taken to the emergency room was on 9/11, and she was very supportive. We've been through hundreds of tests, and she's always been there if I'm scared, if I'm nervous. There to pray with me, there to say something encouraging. She's my confidant. She's the one who I talk to about anything. I have what I call a little cry sessions where every few months I just get a little down because I can't do something, or, you know, just little things are stacking up that are really making me upset. And she'll just listen to and hear me out. And she's willing to help me because, you know, there's some times where maybe I'm not having a good day, and she says, okay, I'll help you with this. She's always willing to get my meals if I can't do that. She's just very, very supportive.
Right, now think about one person, whether it be a family member or a friend, former friend, who has not been helpful or supportive. How have you coped or come to terms with this lack of support? And some of you have kind of answered this already, but let me know if you have anything else or new that you'd like to say about that.
I don't really have anybody. Like I said, I have a very close, tight family. Both my immediate family and my church family. The only problem that I've had is where, even though they're trying to be supportive, someone can just not understand that I can't do a certain thing. So, you know, even though they may be very sympathetic or something, well, for example, I have a Bichon, a puppy, and I'm in charge of her grooming. So I'll pull out the piano bench and put a towel over it, and she gets up on it. Well, some days I'm just so weak, I can't hold the piano bench out. And I'm going, I need a little help. You need help moving a piano bench. So, you know, that sometimes I have to explain to them that. But other than that, everybody's been very supportive, and I've been extremely blessed and fortunate in this.
I think for me that I just need to remember and remind myself and keep in mind that it's not that people are trying to be
rude about it, that they just don't understand, and I need to try not to take it out on them personally when there is a misunderstanding, or if they choose to handle it poorly, it's not my fault. There has been a few people that, you know, friendships that I've had to kind of steer away from a little bit because they don't understand and they're not willing to like work around it, but I need to remember that it's not my fault and that it's okay. It's okay if they don't want to deal with it, that there's nothing I can do about that, and I might as well just appreciate the friendships and relationships that I have. So
I don't think I really have much to add to that. That's basically the experience that I've had is with the friends that I have had in the past who are not that supportive, or in some cases even kind of believe there was anything wrong, that did my best to explain to what was going on and then just kind of left it in their court. And unfortunately, there's been some that I, you know, that were no longer friends, just they didn't quite get it. And others, I mean, it took a little time for them to really wrap their mind around things, and we're really good friends now, so.
One thing to add is be careful in selecting roommates, because those are difficult situations. I had one who just, seriously, anytime like I would drive to campus and she's like, I can't believe you drive to campus, and then would just like leave the room, and like anytime she'd start something and then just like leave. So yeah, that's something I would suggest. Yeah.
Erin, did you say just letting those kinds of comments roll off at you? Is that how you felt it?
Oh, yeah, I didn't deal with it, but it's kind of hard when you share a kitchen with someone and you're not really even friends with them, so they don't really feel, it's difficult to manage those sort of things, because you can't really, if you're your friend, you could discuss things in a deeper level because they would actually care more about you than, yeah, so that was probably the trickiest, like, sort of relationship that I've had to deal with in regards to that. But yeah, eventually she moved out and I moved out, so that's really the only solution to people, I think, that just really don't get it and who really just don't think they should get it, which is, you know, it's impossible for you to really do anything about.
Well, I had a lot of friends on the football team who I had to stop playing. They didn't really understand, you know, they kind of make comments, you know, like, drink, you know, you can drink a Mountain Dew in the morning and get up and be fine. I'm a Red Bull, you know, I'm really fine. And, you know, if they don't, you know, make enough time to see you, then they're really not your friends. I don't know. But, yeah.
Describe one challenge you have faced in school and ways you have found to be successful in attaining your educational goals.
Well, obviously, when you can't get there very much, it's hard to keep up. But I found that for about the last 2 years, I've had to, you know, do all my math just out of the lessons from the book. And I found that that's actually really helpful. Just you use the resources that they provided for you because they're actually really helpful. And then we're doing some online as well. But yeah, we don't have any homework.
If I could just do two small ones, I've had tons of challenges, and I think graduating high school was a huge battle for me. Because I had gone through and my counselor just said, oh, don't worry about it, we'll figure everything out whenever, senior year, just take as many classes as you can, try and do the online schools and, you know, work things out. And so I show up senior year talking about credits with the same counselor. And he's like, well, I just don't think it might, it's not gonna end up working. You'll have to either go to Horizonte or just take another couple years. And I was just in complete shock. So I ended up having to meet with the principal and people from the school board to, you know, plead my case that, you know, that I had worked hard as I could, that people had not been honest with me about what would be expected on their end. And so it was able to be worked out. But I would suggest, if you're in high school, to make sure everything is clear and everything is like laid out, so you have a clear graduation plan and both sides are clear on what is to be expected. And also, my freshman year in college, the campus at BYU, it's not the biggest, but it was still really difficult for me to imagine being able to walk to class and to get into, going up. Well, the buildings are really difficult to maneuver. There's a lot of walking to be done. So I actually used a powered wheelchair for that year to get to my classes, and that was a huge help. I don't think I would have been able to make it as far as I am now without that year of being able to use that. And it was a very difficult thing for me to manage. There's a lot of stigma attached to it. People don't expect, people felt almost like I was cheating them, or, you know, I was just lazy, or, you know, why on earth can, I mean, you can walk, but why aren't you going all, you know, why are you using a wheelchair? And it was, I don't know, it was difficult for me. So I wouldn't necessarily say, oh, it's for everyone, but if you really are determined to do something, there is generally a way to do it. And you have to really just kind of put your pride aside, put social stigmas aside, and go for it.
Well put. let's see. Well, Aaron kind of said it really well, but I wrote down a couple things of what I wish I had known. I didn't find out what I had until I was. I struggled and scraped through my first couple years of college, and it was so. I think the calling it a battle or a war is a really good description, because it is. You realize that I'm not just struggling to learn here; I'm just struggling to survive and to get to class. Like they're saying, is the hardest thing. I remember getting. I went to Salt Lake Community College, and their buildings are spread out pretty well, and the parking, usually I have to park 2 miles away to get in, and I'd usually fall asleep as soon as I got to class after hiking in, and I wouldn't learn anything. And so one trick I wish I had known is to get a handicap parking pass, and being able to park up close to the buildings. And one thing I wish I had done was not being afraid to talk to your professors and talk to your teachers and actually develop a relationship with them. And it's best to do it when you set up a special meeting with them. If you go to them after class, they're usually busy and distracted, and it's hard to really get their full attention. So if you could set up a special meeting, we usually have office hours, and really make sure you have them with you and willing to work with you. And what's hard for me is to realize that you can work out arrangements that aren't exactly in the rules. You know, just because the syllabus says we're going to do this, this, and this, it's okay to talk to your teacher and say, I know the assignments are due every Monday, but what if we work out something else? So think outside the formal rules and realize they don't always have to apply to you. Especially when you get to college, you're basically a paying customer. And that's one thing I didn't realize. I'm used to the teacher relationship, you know, where you're the student and you're bowing down to your teachers. But in college, it should be more of working with your professor, because you're paying them to teach you. And so you should remember that. I wish I had known that.
The biggest issue that I had in high school and then now in college was effort that it does take to get to class. I would do the same thing, that sit down, you know, get all my stuff out, and then fall asleep or completely zone out and miss the majority of the lecture or the class and really not learn anything. And so how we kind of got around that was really proactive with my counselors in high school and my teachers, and then working with the Disability Resource Center now at school, and just using the technology that's out there. So I have my little miniature tape recorder that I take, and I record all of my lectures, and I take my own notes, and then I also have another student in the class taking notes on carbon copy paper. And so they have their own notes, and then I get their copies. And so between the three things, and then including the textbook, I usually have good
you know, broad coverage of what we learned in class, and actually turns out to be an amazing study, because you know, you read it and hear it, that works out really well. So, yeah, I found that that was the biggest thing that I had to get into my head was once I did go to college is, you know, don't be afraid to get outside the syllabus or outside of what is written down on the paper. That a lot of professors are very, very willing to work with you if you're willing to work with them and really explain about it. And I found that most of them are incredibly interested in what's going on with me and ask for regular updates. And I still talk to quite a few of my professors and no longer in the classes with. So.
My biggest challenge was getting through my senior year so that I could graduate. And I think the best thing that I have done and will continue to do is to just be okay with changing my goals and adjusting to my own condition. And now I'm not like, oh, I am going to totally graduate from college by the time I am 25. Now my goals are, you know what, I'm going to graduate from college, even if I'm 80 years old when I do it. So I think that, and I think that I will probably take up other people's advice and go through the disability program and see what they can help me with. And just remember that I may only be able to take one class a semester, and that's okay, and there's nothing wrong with that.
I have not been to college yet. I'm hoping to graduate this spring, but like they said, I would be willing to take an extension on that. I have a hard time with studying and memorization. It's a big challenge for me. And I have quizzes like every 3 or 4 lessons in each of my classes. So it's kind of hard for me to get through the quizzes. Another thing that's been a frustration to me is in my grade, I'm a really good student, and I know that if I were better, I could get like straight A's probably, but I'm half needing to settle for more B's and C's, and that's really frustrating to me because I know that I could do better if I wasn't so sick. So, just struggle through and see what I can get done.
To those of you who are in your 20s, how do you see yourself, or would you like to see yourself, in terms of leading an independent life as an adult, potentially with chronic fatigue syndrome and fibromyalgia?
I think for me, one of my biggest goals is just when I'm a mom, I want to be able to make it to all of my kids' things, or as many as I possibly can. I may not make it to everything. And it's been nice as I've been getting a little bit better to kind of gain some independence, and I just plan to continue that by one day being stable enough to move out and be able to pay for my own things and take care of myself, and then maybe get married and take care of kids one day. So
I'm really looking forward to the time when I can move out. Love my parents, but I want out. You know, the biggest goal right now is getting to a point where I can support myself and live on my own and be able to be financially independent from my parents. That's really what I'm looking forward to and getting my way towards that direction. And hopefully in the next couple of years or so, I'll be able to do it.
Well, I was laughing at what Amy said because I'm married and have a child, and I'm still not out. We live with my parents right now, which is actually a blessing and a curse. And I just think everyone said that really well. As far as how I'd like to see myself, I think I'm doing the very best that I can possibly do, and so I'm just going to be okay with that for right now. And keep going. My motto is one day at a time.
Yeah, I think that one of the struggles I've had is just trying to redefine what my independence can be. It's impossible for me to be pushing myself so that I can, you know, have a full-time job and you know, go to school and graduate, become a 21, all the stuff that, as she was saying before. And I think that I've been a lot happier when I've come to terms with the fact that I will need help for a lot of things for most of my life, and that's okay, even though I'm an adult now, and I should, you know, most people my age are different. It's not that I should be like that, it's just...
Right, to those of you who are married, what words of advice do you have for other young persons with chronic fatigue syndrome and fibromyalgia who may be thinking about marriage in their future?
I would say just not to... I think I was really intimidated by the idea of it. I'd always kind of thought that I would have to be in a different place in my life than I am now, even after I've been married for 2 years. I'm not completely healthy. I'm not, you know, all these things that I guess, through all the redefining I've had to do of what my goals will be, I hadn't really redefined my goals as far as marriage. And then I met my husband, and he just was, he understood me almost immediately, it seemed, whenever I had to explain the handicap placard in my car on our first date. He was just like, oh, okay, you know. And I think that his acceptance for who I was made me think that, you know, we wouldn't really have your typical marriage, but it would, you know, I wanted to be with him, and he seemed like he would be with me, so I figured I'd give it a shot, but yeah.
It's an interesting challenge to be a young person coming down with this illness before you get married. I was thinking about the people who already are adults and married with children and busy households who get it then and have to deal with all that craziness, where here people were starting out this way. So in some ways maybe it's an advantage, because whoever we marry, they know what they're getting into. It's not a surprise later on. And so my husband is just like Aaron's, where he's very understanding, and he's just that easygoing personality. And I think it's tricky to find someone, but there's a lot of great people out there. And in general, just as everyone's been very positive tonight, I think people really are generally understanding. And you might be surprised. But before, when you're younger and you don't know if you'll get married or when you'll get married, and you have all these doubts and ifs and whens, and somehow it works out, and you have to have faith that there's more to you than your illness, and other people will see that if you give them a chance and if they want to. I think as far as advice goes, I just think make sure that the person that you're thinking about marrying or dating, they understand what daily life is like with this condition and know the roller coaster ride that it can be, and marry you for who you are now and who you can be in the future. And the other thing is to, if you can both have the attitude that it's our illness, it's not just you and your problem, it becomes our problem. That's a really healthy way to enter marriage with this condition.
To the parents on our panel, what words of advice do you have for others with chronic fatigue syndrome or fibromyalgia who may be contemplating parenthood?
Parenthood? Wowzer. Well, I mean, my little guy over there, he's so cute. How can you not want one? That's a really loaded question, because we got through the marriage thing that we just talked about, and all of a sudden, what's the next thing? Kids. And I think you think about it in terms of what makes you happy. What's your drive and your passion in life? And for me, it was being a mother and a wife, and it's what I've always wanted to do. And it took quite a long time to come to terms with who I am now, and I'm not going to be super mom that I thought I was going to be. And it's been quite a pride pill to swallow, and it's hard to accept help where even though I'm a stay-at-home mom, We have a babysitter that helps every day in the mornings, and that's very hard for me. But it's worth it because it's my passion life. So I would say if you're considering, you're married and you're thinking about kids, if that's your passion, then go for it. If it's something else, go for it. Just don't put your life on hold. That's what Dr. Bateman told me, and maybe all of you. Don't put your life on hold. Just adjust and keep moving, even if it's not the way you want. And so I do recommend it. It's worth it. I think I like to think of how deep your pain is and sorrow. That's how great your joy is, and I feel that way about my family. And that little guy is just the cutest. I wish he was awake to show him off, but he's asleep.
To all of our panelists, is there anything specific you would like to suggest or tell family members in the audience or at home that you think would be helpful to their loved one or to you personally with chronic fatigue syndrome and fibromyalgia? And this could be a parent, a sibling, grandparent, aunt, uncle, cousin, etc.
I like what Jessica said. She said, don't let your illness define you. You don't have to have, everyone doesn't have to know you as the person who can't do anything or boring person who just do that all day. They can know you for all your other qualities. Just make them like you for other reasons.
Some of my family members, it was hard for them to see me so different than who I used to be, even years after. And I think that it's easy for that to happen, but what's best is to, I think that everyone in the family needs to go through, I think that, kind of a period of mourning and adjustment, and everyone kind of needs to go through the same thing that your family member with chronic fatigue and fibromyalgia is going through, just to be really sympathetic and to allow yourself to show weakness too. You don't have to be happy all the time and pretend like nothing's wrong. You know, you can show that, you are, this is difficult for you too. I think that would have really made things easier for me through the adjustment process.
Probably one word is listen. And I really like what Amy said about her father, who would watch for not verbal cues. That was really neat, because sometimes the hardest thing to do is explain yourself, and it's so hard to say I don't well, because when you don't feel well all the time, you get tired of repeating yourself, and you know they get tired of hearing it, and so you just quiet down, and you don't talk, and so watching for the nonverbal cues is very, very good.
The biggest issue that I had, especially with my extended family, is they'd always be asking, oh, are you doing okay? Are you doing okay? And I love them to death, and they absolutely love me. It's coming from such a great place, but that actually would really, really ride on my nerves quite quickly. Because, within 15 minutes, my status probably didn't change all that much. And so just really, pay attention to nonverbal cues, what's going on in the situation, and to kind of adapt and to kind of accept.
For me, the best thing is just unconditional love, that you aren't going to feel any different just because I'm different or because that person is different. You're going to love them all the same, no matter what. That's been great for me, for people that really just love me unconditionally, no matter how I'm feeling or what I can do in my life at this time. And so I would say you just love them.
I guess for me, the biggest challenge is, asking for help and then not wanting help. I have, I want to be independent. I think everybody does. But there are times when maybe we don't want to be dependent on someone, but we really do need help. So we kind of watching for that. My mom will notice if my legs start to tremble, you know. I don't want to sit down, but she'll know that she needs to get my lunch or something. And, you know, be willing to help with everyday tasks. There's no way I could help clean house or anything like that. So, you know, things like chores that you might have done before, they may not be possible anymore. And even, you know, brothers and sisters may have a hard time understanding you can't do your chores anymore. But that means I've got more chores. So, you know, just be really understanding about that.
How do you respond to that, Bethany?
Well,
possibly makes a comment like that to you.
Well, usually I tell them I'm sorry, but I understand how they feel, but I'm sorry, I just cannot handle it right now. And sometimes I'll explain that why, what I'm feeling, what my symptom is at this moment that's keeping me from doing what I'm doing, what I need to do.
Have any of our other panelists had similar experiences with siblings resenting having to take on more chores because you're not doing your share by their perspective?
Yeah, it was very much, it's just my sister and I, and we were both still living at home, you know, we had our chores, that they were, you know, pretty even, and then when I could no longer do those, she was really good about it for the first month or so. And then she started, she's like, okay, time for you to get better and start helping me a little bit. So, it just became kind of a love-hate relationship that we really joke about it a lot now. And I found ways that I could help out in other places. Like, I became the resident shopper of the house. I would sit down at the counter with my knife and cutting board. And, anything that needed to be prepared for dinner, that was my job. And, you know, I could do that. And so, just found real little things, kind of the annoying tasks that nobody really wanted to do, that you can do while sitting down, that became my job. And so, Kristen was a lot better about that. She didn't have to do the stuff she didn't like anymore, so.
I just want to say, too, that please know that it's not like we're trying to get out of things. In fact, more than anything, we want to be able to do those things because it's a loss for us to not. I mean, I know that sounds weird. It's a loss that you can't make your bed anymore because normally that's something that people would like to get out of. But when we no longer can do those things for ourselves, it is hard. It's a loss for us. And so we're not looking for ways to put other people out and to get out of things and to add to other people's chores. And we go through a lot of guilt, too, feeling like, I mean, I don't know if you guys do, but feeling bad that other people do have to compensate for what you can't do. So just know that we're not trying to get out of things, and really it's hard for us, too.
Wait, so what do you all think about the name, chronic fatigue syndrome?
And I think our reaction pretty much said it all.
Yeah,
just
kind of
frowning and
eye-rolling. So everybody's up for a change, which hopefully will be coming soon, yes. Are there any comments for that? Family members in living with chronic fatigue syndrome and fibromyalgia?
My mom has always been very much a stickler for grades. And she had a difficult time accepting possible loss of grades, and especially in math, I had a really hard time going from trying to do really well to trying to just pass. Mm-hmm. Passing math for me was such a wonderful, wonderful thing. And I think the biggest issue that I really wanted was to just full acceptance that I'm not going to be able to get the A's, B's, or even C's in some of these subjects, and just to be, you know, to really accept that and see it as a real triumph and celebrate that. But then also, I think it's really difficult because pushing is really good to a point, and then gets to a point where it, you know, step over the limit. And I just found that doing it in kind of the background, like lots of encouragement, lots of very, very positive encouragement, that always pushed me just by myself because, yay, I'm happy, so I'm going to try a little bit harder type of thing, so.
I think for me, as far as pushing goes, one time to always push is when someone's feeling down. To push them to do something that's going to get them up a little bit, and you can find things that don't take too much energy. So like, I don't know if you feel this way, but if she were down and having kind of a bad day, to push to do something that might lift her up, like, what would you like me to do with you to bring you up? Or I'm trying to think. It's hard because it's different for everybody, but always just ask a lot of questions and say, you know, feel free to ask questions. Don't hesitate to say, oh, how are you feeling today? Because it is different every day how far you can push. One day you can push all the way up to here, and another day only to here. And so the best thing to do is to just ask a lot of questions and just figure out where they're at that day. And I think don't push in physical ways, because those are the most difficult, is pushing someone to get up and do chores type of things. You know, those are hard to always do, but I don't know.
On that note, I'd like to conclude tonight's meeting by a round of applause for our panelists. Please join me. Thank you. Thank you all for coming.